In the previous videos, we have identified the assumption of scholarship with regards to dating the Exodus, namely that it is recorded as taking place in the 13th century before Christ, during the reign of Ramses II. We also examined the overall framework of ancient Egyptian chronology and the key Bible passages that point us to the time of the Exodus. As stated previously, the majority of the debate surrounding the date of the Exodus is centered on the 18th and 19th royal dynasties of pharaonic Egypt, during the period historians refer to as the New Kingdom. The reasons for this have to do with the placement of ancient Egyptian chronology in relationship to some absolute dates preserved, or at least implied, within the biblical text. The result of this is that there are two major views espoused for the Exodus date. An early date, which places the Exodus during the 18th dynasty, and a late date, which places it in the 19th dynasty. This may seem like a small difference on paper. However, the time period encompassed between the beginning of the 18th and the end of the 19th dynasties is roughly 400 years. Depending on which date a scholar prefers, they will be influenced in one direction or the other by multiple centuries. As I mentioned in the first video of this series, this influence can have huge ramifications when considering the body of historical and archaeological evidence. Artifacts and documents that are offered as proof by one position are disregarded by the other due to conflicting assumptions. Before proceeding, there is one more piece of evidence we need to consider in attempting to identify the date of the Exodus. Ramses II's reign was approximately 65 years, one of the longest pharaonic reigns in all of ancient Egyptian history. As such, he died an old man and actually outlived some of his sons who would have otherwise succeeded him. The prince who finally did succeed Ramses was named Merenptah, Ramses' 13th son, himself already an older man when he came to power. For this reason, he only ruled for around 10 years before he died. During his reign, though, Merenptah erected a stele recording campaigns, either by himself or his father and grandfather, in Libya and Canaan. Line 26 of this stele contains the phrase, quote, "Israel is laid waste, his seed is not." For this reason, this stele has become widely known as the Israel stele. The reference to Israel that is recorded here is nearly unanimously accepted among Egyptologists. There is some debate, though, as to whether Israel is being credited with national status at this point, or if they are referred to as a group of nomadic wanderers. Regardless, this represents the first documentation of Israel's existence in history by a foreign power. It also acknowledges Israel's existence independent of Egyptian rule or hegemony. For this reason, the Exodus cannot be dated any later than the reign of Merenptah, roughly 1210 BC by accepted chronology. We will consider further implications of the Israel stele later, but for now, we can reference it as establishing a fixed boundary, which the Exodus must have occurred prior to. With all of the key pieces of data having been considered, we can now examine the proposals for the date of the Exodus. Let me preface myself by saying that every position must engage in some conjecture to make their arguments. This is not to say that such conjecture is unjustified, but that justification for doing so must be substantiated. Let's start with the argument for the late dating of the Exodus, during the 13th century BC, in the reign of Ramses II. As stated, this is the view held to by the majority of current academic scholarship, so it is the view that you are most likely to see expressed in textbooks, lectures, and mainstream documentaries. The late date view gives priority of interpretation to a straightforward reading of Exodus chapter 1, verse 11, which records the Israelites as having been put into forced labor in the construction of Pithom and Ramses. This verse is a textual variant, as the Septuagint also includes the city of Ono, commonly known as Heliopolis by Greek authors. However, the Septuagint reading is likely not the original in this case, as the Dead Sea Scrolls do not reflect the addition of Un. While the location of Pithom is somewhat debated, Egyptology has confirmed the existence of the city of Ramses in the Nile Delta region of Egypt, not far from the proposed location of Goshen, the region where Jacob and his family settled when they came to Egypt. This city was one of the many constructed by Ramses II during his long reign as pharaoh. It is likely that Pithom was located nearby, as Ramesside remains have been discovered at other sites in the region, most probably Tel el-Rataba. Remember, though, that this verse is one of three we presented as the main passages pointing to the date of the Exodus. How does this position accord with the other passages? 1 Kings chapter 6 verse 1 records the Exodus as taking place 480 years before Solomon began to construct the temple in Jerusalem. This verse is also a textual variant. The Septuagint gives a date here of 440 years. We don't know which reading is more likely to be the original, as the Dead Sea Scrolls are not preserved at this portion of Scripture. Regardless, the fourth regnal year of Solomon is almost unanimously accepted at 966 BC. 480 years prior to 966 would be 1446 BC. If the reading of the Septuagint is to be preferred, then 440 years before would be 1406 BC. Herein is where the late date view runs into its first point of conjecture. Ramses II reigned during the 13th century BC, approximately the years 1280 to 1215, around 200 years after the date recorded in 1 Kings chapter 6. Late date proponents therefore argue that the date recorded in this verse should not be regarded as literal, but as symbolic. The argument goes that 480 is a multiple of 12 and 40, two numbers that are emphasized heavily across the Old and New Testaments. It is true that many instances where multiples of these numbers are used are done so with symbolic significance. The argument then proceeds that 40 is the ideal number of years regarded for a generation. Thus, 480 years should be understood as a euphemism for 12 generations. If this assumption is correct, it follows then that most people did not actually live to be 40 years old in the ancient world. So, if the author of 1 Kings is attempting to say 12 generations, a generation should be regarded as something more like 20 to 25 years. This would equal a total time period of 250 to 300 years. This understanding would place the Exodus around approximately 1266 to 1216 BC, during the middle to the end of the reign of Ramses II. With this being said, are there any problems with the late date view of the Exodus? First, if the late date reading of Exodus 1:11 is correct, then it means that Ramses II is the pharaoh who did not know Joseph. This also means that Moses would have been born during the reign of Ramses II and raised in his household, perhaps as one of his many princes. The Exodus itself would have taken place later, perhaps during the reign of Merenptah. However, this becomes a problem, because Merenptah's Stele records the autonomous existence of Israel in Canaan during his reign. The Exodus, therefore, had to have occurred before his time as pharaoh. This means that Ramses II must also be regarded by late-date proponents as the pharaoh of the Exodus. Proposing Ramses II as both the pharaoh who did not know Joseph and the pharaoh of the Exodus has a hard time being reconciled with the biblical testimony. Exodus chapter 2 verse 23 records that, quote, the king of Egypt died during Moses' years of flight in Midian before he met the angel of the Lord in the burning bush on Mount Sinai. Regarding the late date reading of 1 Kings chapter 6 verse 1, it is highly, if not entirely, speculative. This is not to say that it is wrong, but that it relies heavily on assumption rather than exegesis of the biblical text. There isn't anything overt in the passage that tells us to interpret 480 years as a symbolic reference. Further, I believe that the presence of a textual variant at this verse actually undermines the symbolic reading of this number. If, quote, 480 years was a reference to 12 generations, how do we account for the reading of 440 years found in the Septuagint? While there is some substance to citing 12 and 40 as ideologically important numbers for the Israelites, the same cannot be said for the number 11, the Septuagint reading being 11 times 40 according to this logic. When attempting to interpret a passage that is a text variant, the interpretation that is likely to be correct should account for each of the variant readings. I don't believe that the symbolic interpretation of 1 Kings chapter 6 verse 1 does a sufficient job to account for the variant reading found in the Septuagint. The late date view also has some difficulty with Jephthah's testimony, recorded in Judges chapter 11 verse 26, that Moses had led Israel into Ammonite territory 300 years before the time of his speech. Jephthah's lifetime is recorded as approximately 1100 BC, so 300 years prior to his time would have been around 1400 BC, again, too early to coincide with a Ramesside exodus. Further, as Professor Israel Finkelstein mentioned,
the attempts to locate the events in the 13th century BC in the time of Pharaoh Ramses II have faced insurmountable difficulties.
In the next video, we will consider the strengths and weaknesses of the early date of the Exodus. Please subscribe and click the notification bell so that you will be notified when I release the upcoming videos in this series. For further reading on this subject, I recommend Israel in Egypt by James Hoffmeyer and Kingdom of Priests by Eugene H. Merrill. You will find links to each of these books in the description.